11 on February 16th. And I hope you find this series to be informative, even thought-provoking. Meanwhile, let's catch the trailer for The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe.
This is for Crane, I'm afraid so. The film, like the book, tells a story of four siblings: Peter, Susan, Edmund, and Lucy, who are evacuated from London during the bombing of the Second World War. And they're sent to stay in the house of a mysterious old professor. And by the way, this actually happened.
Anyway, under the guidance of the noble and mysterious ruler called Aslan, who is a lion, the children join and eventually lead the fight to free Narnia from the witch's evil spell forever. Now, a critical part of the storyline, and yes, spoiler alert, if you do not have the book or not seen the movie, you may wish to go to your ears. A critical part of the storyline occurs when a disgruntled Edmund, he's the second boy of the four children, betrays his siblings and Aslan, and sides with the White Witch. He later regrets this action and is rescued just as Janice is about to have him killed. But she protests. She approaches and intrudes to parley with Aslan, insisting that according to the deep magic from the dawn of time, she has the right to execute Edmund for treason. That is the law. Aslan speaks to the private legal stranger to announce a claim. That evening, Aslan secretly leaves the camp, but Susan and Lucy follow him. Aslan has bargained his own life for Edmund's. Janice orders Aslan to be bound and laid upon the stone table. She then kills him with a knife. The next morning, the stone table is broken, and Aslan is restored to life, telling Lucy and Susan that deeper magic from before the dawn of time, which Janice did not know about, will resurrect an innocent killed in place of a traitor. So that's the key part of the story. The movie was, for the most part, well received by critics and audiences alike. One well-known critic, Stephen Radinus, makes this comment. He says, Addison's film, Addison, the director, Addison's film is neither as daring nor as visionary as it should have been, nor is the screenplay as faithful to the source material as it could have been. Nevertheless, the film brings Lewis's story to life with sufficient fidelity and movie magic to make it one of the best and brightest family films in some time. So that's the film. Now, how does it get us thinking about God or faith or spiritual matters? Now, I almost asked the worship ministry's team to reject this lecture, because I thought the connection to matter spiritual was too obvious. And after all, this was supposed to be a series on non-religious films that promote discussion. But I've learned something about films. The thing about films is, what's completely obvious to one person in a film may be completely missed by another person watching the same film and sitting next to the person in the movie theater seat. I know someone who still hasn't figured out the significance of Rosebud in the classic film Citizen Kane. Just saying. So not everybody gets what we think is obvious.
simply wanted to write a tale that captured the imagination. Only later did certain time-honored truths begin showing up here and there as he wrote the story, almost as if they had a life of their own. He says, "At first I had very little idea how the story would go, but then suddenly, as an actor, he bombed me into it. I think I had imagined a good many dreams of lions by that time. Apart from that, I don't know where the lion came from or why he came. But once he was there, he pulled the story together, and soon he pulled the six other lion stories in after." He was at a school in Maryland trying to explain the parallel between Aslan and Christ to fifth graders. What was the name of that show? Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? He replied, "I did not save myself. Let us represent Jesus as it really is in our world by a lion in Narnia." I said, "Let us suppose that there were land on Narnia and that the Son of God, as he became a man in our world, became a lion there. And then imagine." Now, there are many other spiritual themes in the lion, witch, and the murderer, such as sacrificial love, good versus evil, relationships, truth, forgiveness, jealousy, temptation, the journey of life, winter into spring, battle and celebration, and so much more. But I think that the primary theme The problem is that nowadays, when we use the word redemption in English, it's not used quite in the same way. If we hear on television or read somewhere about someone that is looking for redemption, it typically is a celebrity, or a sports leader celebrity in particular, who somehow missed out on a first chance at success and managed to work into a second situation where now they might be able to succeed. Okay? They talk about that as redemption. Apparently, Peyton Manning is seeking redemption. Although that's not really clear to me, why would someone make over $20 million? You know, I don't know, but apparently he needs redemption for the people this coming Sunday for the Super Bowl. Well, see, that's the way the word redemption is thrown out in modern language, but that's not the way it used to be used. Historically, redemption has meant something else. It has referred to an individual who is trapped in dire circumstances, who can only be freed by the sacrifice of another. And that's the meaning of redemption, the lion, the witch, and the murderer. And of course, Aslan represents the innocent who gives himself and makes a sacrifice for Edmund, who is then set free, he's redeemed. But if you think about it, it wasn't just Edmund who needed redemption. Remember, all of Narnia was under this spell, this evil spell. All of Narnia needed to be. This parallels our experience in the real world. Our world seems to be under a spell. And so we wonder, who's going to get us out of this mess? And we believe the answer is Jesus Christ. Our need for redemption is why Christ came into the world in the first place. God and Jesus Christ has come to us, the Lion of conquer sin and death. The life, death, and resurrection of Jesus make redemption to mankind.
there is a scene in the book right after Aslan returns to life that is not in the movie, left out of the movie. And I think deliberately so, because I don't think most people, even most church people, would have understood it. And yet for me, this scene that is in the book is every bit as powerful and significant as Aslan returning to life. The context of the book and the film are the same. Narnia is on the verge of war. A great battle is about to begin. People need to be rescued from the witch's castle. So in the film, as soon as Aslan is resurrected, he and Susan and Lucy rush off to take care of business. But in the book, they do not rush off to take care of this important business. Instead, they are overwhelmed by the joy of the moment. They chum. They clap. They play tag. And they laugh. And they jump some more and they laugh some more. Oh, children, said the lion, I feel my strength coming back to me. Oh, children, catch me if you can. He stood for a second, his eyes very bright, his limbs quivering, lashed himself with his tail. Then he made a leap high over their heads and landed on the other side of the table. Laughing, though she didn't know why, Lucy scrambled over to reach him. Aslan leaped again, and a mad chase began. Round and round the hilltop he led them. Now, hopelessly out of their reach, now laying them almost catch his tail, now diving between them, now tossing them in the air with his huge and beautiful velvet paws and catching them again, and now stopping unexpectedly so that all three of them roll over together in a happy, laughing heap of fur and arms and legs. Such a romp as no one had ever had, except in Narnia. And whether it was more like playing with a thunderstorm or playing with a kitten, Lucy